Don't you just hate it when you go to a party and the first thing that people ask you is, so, what do you do? Whenever I get asked this question, just sort of by instinct, I'll say, I'm a program manager at Microsoft and I work on enterprise software. And immediately you can sort of see the other person's mind go like, oh, okay, you're one of those like super technical math programming people. And in my head, I'm always like, oh, great. Now I have to talk about computers for the rest of the evening. It's true that I work in software engineering, but I'm also an illustrator and designer. I love singing, and I help to teach computer science in high schools. I'm really active in diversity and inclusion. And for the longest time, I thought I wanted to go into academia and research, until I changed my mind. Except I still kind of want to do it a little bit, so. But I also want to keep pursuing my other interests in social engineering and languages and writing. And at some point before I die, I'd like to try being a real musician. So when I was in college, I used to go to career fairs, and recruiters would tell me that I was too unfocused. Meanwhile, I had all these friends who just sort of knew from the first Hello World that they were going to become CS professors, or who were so passionate about politics they couldn't possibly imagine doing anything else. So you obviously know the type of people I'm talking about, and you also know how stressful meeting them can be. You know, you look at them, you're like, man, how do I become like that? How do I figure out what I want to do if I don't just have a single interest? Over the last 6 months or so, I've been doing research on and talking to other people in tech who are like us. People for whom the idea of picking just one of our interests to pursue is like trying to pick one of our children to allow to grow up. It turns out that there are words for people like us. Some books call us scanners or flashers or multipots. You might be more familiar with the idea of a T-shaped person with both breadth and depth, or the Renaissance person, the polymath, who is an expert at many things. Personally, I find these terms to be kind of intimidating, so I prefer a word that was popularized by Emily Wapnick, multipotentialite. Now, everyone's definition of this is a little different, and Emily's skews towards creative types, creative industries. So here's my attempt at a more neutral definition. A multipotentialite is someone who has many diverse interests, who has significant skill in several of them. So any one of them is a potential career path that they could follow. Most importantly, multipotentialites need variety in everything they do. So while most people have lots of interesting things they'd like to be good at someday, multipotentialites feel compelled to pursue those interests, all of them. When I first heard this term, it was a revelation. It was like finding out about emotional labor or asexuality. It was one of those things that changes your perception of how people are supposed to work. And it's a real thing, and there's nothing wrong with being like this. In fact, multipotentialites make extremely valuable employees. In 2013, Brian Utsi and colleagues did a study of almost 18 million academic papers across 50 years. And what they found was that the most groundbreaking, impactful work always came from combinations of unique ideas. More elegantly, Donatella Versace says that creativity comes from a conflict of ideas, and multipotentialites live in that conflict every day. In an era of automation, from disruption from automation and AI, that's a crucial quality for success. Next, just because we've sort of gone down so many different paths, we have more practice with learning how to learn. So we've developed the skills to quickly ramp up our projects, and we've probably figured out learning techniques and hacks like deliberate practice or spaced repetition. And finally, having a multipotentialite on a team is like having a squad of mini specialists who all like each other and can understand each other. So we bring a broader range of knowledge to solve problems with, and we can see things that sometimes others miss. We speak the language of multiple disciplines and can easily translate between them. This is obviously super valuable in startups, but actually even more so at big companies, where silos can tend to form that need to be broken down. So, multipotentialites are pretty awesome, but I'm guessing that you didn't come here to be told how great you are. Instead, I'm guessing that you came here because you saw the word help in the title. So, why do we feel this way? Why do we feel like we need help for being who we are? Ashamed and like we don't belong? Well, there's a lot of social stigma around people who want to do many things, or rather too many things. The phrase jack of all trades used to be a compliment, but these days being a generalist is an insult. Society tends to assume that the more things you do, the worse you have to be at doing them, and traditional career advice is set up for people who want to specialize in one thing. As multipotentialites, we can get bored of non-diverse pursuits. And on the outside, that looks like being lazy or immature or unreliable. Next, there's a growing movement of politicians and tech bros who are spreading the idea that non-STEM fields are not important, or that they're somehow intellectually lazy. So you take that and add it to the fact that women and minorities already face greater pressure to prove themselves technically. What you get is that non-STEM interests can become potential evidence for how we're just naturally less good at this stuff. If a guy tells you that he really likes designing, very few people are going to question if he's also still a competent programmer. But for a woman to say the same thing immediately sort of hits at her credibility. You know, is she a real programmer or does she just design websites? Finally, I know many of you here today are students, and when you're in school, no one really tells you what it means to have a career. So we tend to think that it's a single predefined job that we just take from whatever company is kind enough to give us one. We think that if we pick a job, then it's the first step on being railroaded onto this permanent career path that we can't get off. And we have this idea that progression in a job just sort of means doing the same thing, but at bigger scale. So being a senior engineer just means you write 10 times as much code as a junior engineer. This is not true at all. If you fall off that predefined path, then you weren't good enough to make it all the way to the end. And God forbid that you're not passionate about your job, because, I mean, you might as well not have a job at all. So we end up trying to fit ourselves into these cultural molds, but repressing our natural tendency to wander can lead to burnout, and we face high levels of anxiety around career decisions and how to present ourselves. We end up feeling like maybe we don't have a purpose or like we're imposters in some way. But none of those things actually has to be true. These are just invisible scripts that sometimes we don't even realize we're following. So now that we're more aware of what they are, we can also begin to become more intentional about saying no to them and defining what a career can look like for us. The best way to start, in my opinion, is to create a big map of all your interests. So, you know, write down every single thing you've ever been interested in, and nothing is too small or stupid to include. My list here includes stuff like cleaning my room. As you do this, you'll not only feel a huge sense of relief at finally having this bucket list, but you also start to see themes emerge for the type of work that you're interested in or the problems that you like to solve. These themes are the foundation for figuring out how to work with instead of against your interests. Next, I'm just going to go over four quick options that you may have heard of or haven't considered yet for using those and creating a career. So option one, and the most obvious one, is to just find or create a job that has that kind of variety built into it. The nice thing about CS is that you can sort of apply it to anything, so you just take what you found and combine those and append tech to the end. In my case, I ended up in program management because The job of the PM is, at least at where I work, the job of the PM is to ship great products by doing the stuff that nobody else wants to do. So that might mean writing a bunch of really influential emails to make a case for something, or going out to customers and doing research, talking to them and figuring out what they want. Someone else doing this is Liza Knipscher, who studied biology, psychology, and art in undergrad. She went to school for medical illustration afterwards and taught herself how to code. And these days, she's a medical app and game developer who creates apps and games for patient education. If one job isn't enough, you can also consider multiple jobs. So again, it's kind of obvious, but yeah. This idea is not new to anyone who has had to work three jobs just to pay rent, and I'm not trying to trivialize that. But it is something that you don't hear about as much in tech. So again, I'll give you two quick examples of people who are doing this today. Pinky Weitzman is the chief digital officer of the American Civil Liberties Union. And she's also a professional rock musician who has toured with some of the best bands in the world, including one of my favorites, the Magnetic Fields. Lindsay Scott is the lead iOS developer at a fundraising startup. She's also an accomplished actor and model who has worked for brands like Calvin Klein and Louis Vuitton. Just to be clear though, I think this option is kind of unrealistic for most people. Like, when I get home from work, all I want to do is just lie down. So if you don't have the amazing self-discipline of these women, something else, again, that is obvious but not often considered, is to have multiple jobs, but one after another. Just picking one job to go into now doesn't mean you have to stay there, and I think this comic really exemplifies that. It's a panel from a strip built around the idea that if it takes 10,000 hours to become a master at something, you have basically 11 chances in life to lead completely different lives, being masters at completely different things. What's even better is that you don't actually need to become an expert at the things you take on. As long as you figure out what you want from each experience, it's fine to say, I'm done, and move on after that. Lastly, let's say you've tried everything else and none of the options are really working out for you. You can intentionally choose to have what Barbara Scher calls a good enough job. So I say this and the recruiters are going to hate me, and it's like some kind of terrible dirty secret, because there's a lot of hyperbole in our industry around the idea of work. Your job is supposed to be, you know, like your life passion. It's supposed to be this all-consuming flame that burns up everything you touch. But I mean, that's, you know, the myth that your job is supposed to be your entire identity, that it's supposed to fulfill all your needs, that's just a cruel lie that we tell to each other. It's okay to pick a job that you just like with the intention of doing other stuff that you're more interested in after work. It's okay to go to work and care a lot about what you're doing, work hard, and then go home and do something completely different. If having just a job means that you can pursue your other interests from a place of financial and emotional stability, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. And really, that's what most people do. We just happen to be lucky enough that tech is one of the fields that we genuinely care about and also extremely lucrative. So I've gone through these four options, and I just want to emphasize that, you know, there's really no one right way that your career should look. And for myself, I sort of do a combination of all these things. And just remember that no matter which path you choose, as a multipotentialite, you're extremely valuable. But society needs to change as well. And so when you go home from this talk, I hope you'll get your schools and your employers on board. So start a conversation about what multipotentialites do best and what they bring to the table. If you're an employer, you can consider letting people do consulting gigs across org boundaries, or change the language in your job description so that they appeal to those with multiple interests. At my office, we have this rotating slideshow that goes through and shows pictures of everyone's interests outside of software engineering. Small details like these can make a big difference in creating a more welcoming and inclusive environment. Ultimately, being a multipotentialite is not just about having a lot of interests or doing many things well. It's about changing the way you see self-identity and embracing the fact that you need variety. I hope that this talk has introduced you to a new way of thinking about people, yourself, and your career. So forget what society tells you about career and stop treating yourself as a liability. If you have the time, stay a while afterwards and talk to the people in this room, because these are your people. Thank you so much.